Hello, my dear friends. Happy Sunday. I'm here with my little beautiful girl in the play garden. So there will be some children in the background. But I dedicate today's live show to the small cryptos, because they went up from a bottom of 50 billion, everything except if you exclude Bitcoin, all the other cryptos. The high was about 400 billion, I think. No, higher, 500 billion. And during the bear market of 2018, it went down from 500 billion to 50 billion. And since then, in December 2018, went from 50 billion back up to 120 billion. But then it went back down the last 2 months to 80 billion. That's where we are. Let me share also on Twitter that I started. I'm noticing some signs of depression, and I think this is a red flag in my case, because I up until today I'm thinking the bottom is not in for crypto, but a typical pattern for a typical pattern for crypto. Call it. I accidentally kicked her. A typical pattern for the start of a crypto bull market is that Bitcoin Core goes up first, and only after the smaller coins go up. And at the beginning of the bull market, oh my god, this is not good. I'm gonna change location because baby's crying is not a great backdrop. But at the beginning of a bull market, it's typical that the smaller coins go down versus Bitcoin Core, and this is the pattern that we're seeing. So but just looking also at the price pattern of smaller coins, such as, for example, Obyte that I'm invested in, and Bismuth. Yeah, it's really, it's just depressed. You can't put it any other way. Like, the interest has gone down. There is no excitement around it. Price has, is double bottoming now. For example, for Obyte, it went to $20, went back up to $50, is back at $20, which comes from $800. I think that that it's a good time to, if you have underinvesting cryptos, to really buy some smaller coins. If we get a correction, I think that's really a must, because there is a small chance the bull market has started, and in that case, then this will be the last opportunity to buy smaller coins, because if bull market, you don't know how deep it will correct, but if the bull market has started, it is likely that it will correct only Bitcoin Core to about 7,500, and after that will continue to go up rapidly. Hey Joy. And so, many of these coins, they are very, very, they are cheap. Huh? For example, Obyte, market cap of 15 million. That's cheap. The market cap was 800 million at the peak. That's a very good price. And you already see what coins have, like, survived the bear market or not. Like, some coins, you can see that, yeah, they remain active. And I mean, it doesn't matter if prices get cut by 2 again or by 4 again, the coin will likely survive. Huh? Like, it has enough supporters that are very strong believers and that remain active within the community and continue to contribute value to the project. that these will, if they haven't been shaken out by today, well, they likely will not get shaken out. So you already have some good signs which coins will survive and which coins not. And if you look at fiat valuations, they are already very cheap. So I think this is something to really invest in. If Bitcoin Core corrects to 7,500, I think it's very important to invest in the coins that you have not invested in yet, but you do want to invest in, to take your first serious position, or to double up your position if you have already invested but didn't add anything during this bear market. It may be the last chance to really buy cheap. So I think that's very important. Hi all, welcome to the live show. I'm happy there are some people. There seem to be very low amount of people, only 4. Maybe it's also an indicator of the general crypto market. Let me take a look at the comments. I can see them here. Hey, Ricardo Peters, welcome to the live show. And that's a good question, eh? So you would rather buy small coins rather than BCH and Ethereum? Well, I haven't made up my mind, but at this point I'm planning to do both. I already bought a big Bitcoin Cash position. I was planning to only invest in Ethereum if it corrects more, and go from an allocation of about, if it would correct, I'm now about 35%, I will probably drop to around 25% crypto, most of it Bitcoin Cash, and I'm planning to double that up then to 51% if Bitcoin Core goes to 7,500. I plan to have a majority in crypto invested and sell Tesla for that. But the coins that I plan to buy is mainly Ethereum, because I don't have that yet. I only have Bitcoin Cash, and I have done some smaller coins, Obyte and Bismuth. I have decided that I will also invest more in smaller coins while I buy Ethereum. But I will mainly buy Ethereum because I do believe that in the next phase, if we are in a bull market, the next phase is that the bigger coins will go up, not the smaller ones. Eh? But of course, not Bitcoin Core. That's dumb. In market share dominance, it has really reached a peak, very likely. But now it's time for some others like Ethereum, Bitcoin Cash, some bigger ones, Ripple, to pump. So I think the wisest is to invest in the bigger coins. But smaller coins are sometimes so small that you can't easily take in a position. It takes a long time to build a position, except if you want to pump the price and double the price or add 20 or 30% to the price. Yeah, then you can take in a position because you're pumping the price. But for most small coins, you want to take in a decent position. It will take a long time to do that if you don't want to influence the price. And so I think it is wise to start buying those coins also on the next correction, if there comes a correction, for the reason of liquidity, but also for the reason that, well, if we have started the bull market, then well, things go faster than they used to be. Huh? This bull market has jumped much faster than previous bull markets. So the speed of this bull market is clearly faster, and so that means that maybe it will also apply to the next stages where crypto, where the first bigger coins go up and then the smaller ones. Yeah, but it may only take, maybe it's only a couple of months that the big ones pump, and then already the small ones start to pump also, and so there is a very limited amount of time to take in positions in small coins. So this is the reason why you want to buy on the next correction, or even today, is that it's with the assumption that the bull market has started, eh? Because if you assume that the bear market is still on, there is no reason to buy anything. But it's always protecting against different scenarios. And so, the scenario that the bull market has started, you really need to protect yourself against that if you believe in crypto in the long term, by having made sure that you bought enough crypto. So, Yeah, in that scenario, it will be like these smaller coins are already clearly, they are already depressed. They all are already great value buys. I've learned my lesson in previous crypto bull market. For example, it's just like NXT, for example, where I invested in a lot in the previous bull market. After I sold it, it went from a market cap, it bottomed from a 100 million at the peak to a bottom of 7 million market cap, US dollars. Then it went up to 20 million. I didn't believe in the project anymore. I sold them for other cryptos. But after it went to 20 million, that was just the start of the bull market. It went to 2 billion. From 20 million to 200 million to 2 billion. Times 100 from the point where I sold it. I sold it for other cryptos. I'm happy that I did that. I didn't believe in the project anymore. But it does go to show the potential. Like, it's crazy what smaller coins do. And this is for a coin, in my opinion, that has failed. NXT was forked then by the development team into Ardor and Ignis. And basically, NXT today is a dead project and everything transferred to Ardor and Ignis. But they complicated things. They lost the community. It's a failed project and still it went to 2 billion. If you see smaller coins today that actually you think are doing things very well and are likely to continue to build out that cryptocurrency successfully, then these are tremendous buys already. So you have to look at that also and not wait for the optimal time, because you might be that wrong in your timing. I will be that wrong in my timing if the bull market has started. If we go to 7,500, I'm able to buy some more cryptos. After that, it goes up and we go into a bull market. Well, I was that wrong about my timing. So it happens. And you have to protect yourself against that. So yeah, hi all, welcome to the live show. It's very a few amount of people, so I hope you all participate actively. Only 4 people. Hi, Yafule. I'm so great to hear that you love my vids. Feel free to ask any question you like about any topic, and thank you for joining. Does that answer your question, Ricardo Peters? I think the most important thing is to look at your exposure. Like today, I think, let's say you're really underexposed in crypto and you only have 5 or 10% crypto and 90% other stuff. Like, you can't wait for a correction to even for Bitcoin Core to correct to 7,500, because there is a small chance that actually we are at the low today, huh? And we start pumping from Monday. Tomorrow we start pumping and we never see this price again. There's a small chance for that. So if you're really severely underexposed in crypto, I recommend to buy today, because you just can't afford to wait, huh? But that's when you're 5% exposed, 10% exposed. In my case, I'm 35% exposed. That's not a small allocation. And I also have 65% other investments that are actually also great. They have great risk-reward ratio. Tesla is comparable to crypto today in risk-reward ratio. So it all depends on your total portfolio. Also, like say you severely underexposed, 5 to 10%, but the other 90% is investing great investments that you believe have a similar risk reward ratio. Okay, that's another story, but it's still justified probably to balance some to crypto. But in most cases, the other part of the portfolio are bad investments when you look at the risk reward comparison, and are chosen for their safety, not for their potential. Most people have a very big allocation of real estate in their portfolio, their own home or some real estate investments, or a very big allocation of cash, or bonds, or stock index funds. Like these all have much worse risk reward allocations than crypto. And then I don't talk about Bitcoin Core, I talk about Ethereum, Bitcoin Cash, and many, many small coins today have really great risk reward ratio. You can take a position there of 5% in a very small coin, and you may lose it all, but the potential is 1,000x. So you do like 4 projects, you do 5% each. One of them will pan out. That's life changing returns, as Tai Zen always says. I recommend to check out his channel. He makes very good videos, and he made a recent video about don't give up. This is like a moment where people give up, and then he talks about people invest in smaller cryptos. It's true. I also noticed the markets is starting to become depressed, and this is a time where people give up, but actually a good investor is investing in such time. So yeah, we have already reached a great time to invest in smaller coins. So if you haven't done so, I recommend to do. You have 4 BTC. Well, the Tweety Bird, hi, welcome to the show. So you have 4 BTC, do you have any other investments? That's a value of $40,000. Is that your total portfolio? If, like, I really recommend to flip them for other coins today. Like, you can't wait anymore. Bitcoin Core has a 70% market share, this is as good as it gets, very likely. So are there any other coins that you like in the crypto world? Then convert your Bitcoin for that, because that will likely, very likely, prove to be a great move. Ricardo Peters asks, how much percent would you put of your total crypto portfolio into smaller coins? Well, I think that... Hey, how are you?
Hi.
Are you enjoying the play art?
Yes.
Oh, that's nice. I think that... well, in my case, for example, I have 35% crypto now, and about 30% is Bitcoin Cash, and about 5% is smaller crypto. So it's a very small part of my portfolio right now. So right now, I would recommend something similar, like 20% of your crypto portfolio in smaller coins, 80% in bigger coins, such as Ethereum, Bitcoin Cash. But I would recommend 0% today in Bitcoin Core. But I think you can pump that also. It depends. It really depends a lot on your view on that market. Like, the problem with crypto is you really need to study a lot. And in order to find small cryptos that you really believe in, it's a big job. But if you have found one that you say, like, these guys are doing things really well, like, that can be a lot bigger than 20% of your crypto portfolio. The beauty about a bull market is that everything pumps, quality and crap. But the problem of a bull market is that you will sell way too soon. And that's why you should invest in quality, because you need to really strongly believe in it. Otherwise, you will get out when you have a 10x and we'll see it go to 1000x later and miss out on that, because you don't really strongly believe in it. So it's very important today, like, invest in project that you strongly believe in, and plan to, like, not sell it until 2023. And if you found quality projects, and this all depends on your personal dedication, how much time have you invested in studying the crypto market or studying these smaller coins? But if you have invested zero time, then you can't really invest a lot also, because your belief cannot be great and cannot be founded and justified. But if you have really studied the crypto market, then you know some small coins that you really believe strongly in, then you can, like, flip it, and you can say, no, I'm only investing like 20% in Ethereum or Bitcoin Cash or some bigger coins, but I'm going already 80% in smaller coins. And it also depends on the size of your portfolio. If you have a very small portfolio, that certainly is the case, and you can start to dedicate yourself to these projects and earn more cryptos, small cryptos, stash them. Of course, if you have a very big portfolio, it's different. You're not going to be active in some small crypto community project. You're really managing your money, and then you're probably more, it's more wise to wait for the opportune time. And the opportune time is not now for small cryptos. It's likely only in half a year or so, if the bull market starts, and likely first Ethereum, Bitcoin Cash will pump, and then later you convert these into smaller coin projects. But if you're investing with fiat, I think it's already today really worth it. If you flipping piece from fiat or real estate or stocks, very likely these small cryptos are, I are at the fiat bottom today, huh? Not at the Ethereum bottom, not at the Bitcoin Cash bottom, eh? But they are at a fiat bottom. So if you're investing with fiat, yeah, it's a great investment already. Thanks for the question, Ricardo. Nobody you know. It's a great question they're asking. Let's see at my little birdie. Hey, who got it? Eh? How are you, little beautiful girl? Huh? This is my beautiful girl here. Let me go back because there's too much noise here. So he's asking if I averaged down into the smaller coins already. And if you lost 95%, should you do that today? Yes, I think so. Eh? I haven't myself yet. Hey, I'm standing here. Eh? You almost beat on me. This little boy starts peeing here. I think so. If you lost 95%, that's terrible, and I'm sorry for your loss, and that's painful, and it's very difficult to invest more at that stage. But yes, I do think that's the wise choice if you still believe in those projects. If you can see that they've been doing well during the bear market. Of course, they lost people. That's normal. And they lost some projects, of course, that build on top of it. But they are still strong. Yes, double up today. If you're investing with fiat, today is a great time to do that. Because this coin is already depressed, probably. I hope that's helpful. Anything else we can discuss? It's a very low participation today. 6 people. It's strange, because I never had this low. I'm not sure why that is. Oh, the Tweety Bird says that next to his 4 BTC, he also has gold. Well, I really recommend the Tweety Bird to sell the gold fully for crypto. You will not regret that. Gold is I assume you're a young person. Gold is really a waste of your time and your capital as a young person, especially. It's a waste of opportunity. You will realize that in 5 years from here, or already in 1 year or 2 years time. This is really not where your capital should be invested in. Please check my videos on gold. I make very strong case why. You should really focus on crypto if you're into that. The risk reward is much better than gold. Gold actually is very likely in a bear market, and the current $1,500 is likely a peak, and after that it will go down a lot. So in fiat you risk to lose a lot, but in opportunity you risk to lose so much, because losing some fiat value is one thing, but losing a 1000x opportunity, that's quite another, and that's actually what's very likely going to happen if you keep your money in gold, or at least it will happen for all the money that you keep in gold. Thank you for sharing that, the Tweety Bird. Feel free to ask any question, guys. And this is my beautiful little girl. She's 9 months. Huh? Joy? Huh? We got it. Huh? How are you, little girl? Huh? How are you? You like it here? Huh? You like it here? Huh? She talks also, as you can see. Huh? Hey! Let's see. The Tweety Bird asks, do you see a risk that the dollar and other currencies will crash? Well, this is indeed what is shared by Goldbugs, Peter, like Peter Schiff and other people that invest heavily in gold, and they always talk about a currency collapse, a dollar crisis, but they are so wrong. You really have to check out my videos and make strong cases why. In short, actually this is past, like the amount of dollars that the Fed is printing today is negative. They are actually not printing anything the past 3-4 years. They're actually reducing the amount of dollars in circulation. This is what they always do. If you look at history, after a financial crisis, during the financial crisis they print a lot, but after they actually reduce the amount of dollars in circulation. This is a great policy, of course, because then you avoid hyperinflation, you avoid a currency collapse, in contrast to, for example, Venezuela or other banana countries or socialist countries where they keep on printing a lot of money to pay for all their crazy bills, and of course you get hyperinflation. But this is not how currencies are run in the West, in Europe or America. They are a little bit smarter than that. So it's very unlikely that we will get a currency crisis in the West. Do you think the market might keep ranging here for longer? I think it's most likely actually that, as Kevin Svensson points out very well, it will either go up or down. Sideways, we have been going sideways with Bitcoin Core for 2-3 months. And we have gone down with all the other cryptos quite a lot. From a peak of 140 billion to 80 billion, almost cut in two again the past 3 months. So there will come a resolution to this, and it's either up or down. And if it's up, then yeah, this was the last chance to buy at these prices. If it's down, then not. And you will have another great buying opportunity. But in order to embrace that buying opportunity, you really need to prepare for that today. So you really need to look today at your exposure. How much do you want to invest? How much should you have invested, actually, if you could do things over and you can, with the snap of a finger, change your portfolio? What would be your ideal portfolio composition? Think about that and then prepare to buy that also if there's a correction. That's a great move. Yeah, that's what I'm doing. Ricardo Peters, what's your plan how to sell the top? Oh yeah. Yes, so take a look at my video, crypto investment plan, my buy-in plan. You can just search on my YouTube channel. I share the Google sheet that I'm making for that, and I will do that very well in the next bull market. Whenever it happens, I will sell very well at once it reaches serious overvaluation. And in my opinion, you have to look at those videos, but that's when we will reach about 200, last time we went to 700% overvalued, no, 900%. So when we reach about 400% overvaluation over the trend line, then I will sell strong. And I think that the trend line, well, it all depends when the bull market happens. But if the bull market indeed peaks out, happens around 2023, then I think 400% overvaluation. I have to look up my sheet, but I think the trend line will be around 2 trillion or so. So 400% over that is around 10 trillion that I will start sell very, very strong and go to a minority exposure crypto. But before that, I will not sell anything. So that's my plan. Angel. The Tweety Bird asks me, Tweety Bird, thank you for your great questions. I can see that you are informing yourself very well and are asking the right question. What's your thoughts on the danger of, or otherwise, of negative interest rates? I think that negative interest rates, if you look in history, are very rare and are the biggest indicator you can have that we're bottoming out in interest rates. Because can it get much worse than that? No. Huh? Yes, of course it can theoretically, but the chances are very, very low. Like the levels we reached here were unthinkable, unimaginable 10 years ago or 20 years ago. Huh? So if you look at my long-term predictions, my videos where I show the long-term returns of stocks, bonds, interest rates, inflation, this is gold. It's really gold because it shows so clearly what the trend is. And interest rates rise and fall over a very long cycle, much longer than stock markets and commodity cycles. Actually, the interest rate cycle is a combination of one stock cycle and one commodity cycle. And so that means that's about 40, 50 years. And that's one interest rate cycle that, it's not a full cycle, it's the half of it, because as you can see, interest rates went up from a bottom in the 30s, the last Great Depression, to a top in the 70s when gold and commodities went up a lot. So that's like from 30 to 70, that's 50 years that interest rates went from also to, like today, they're negative after inflation of about 5% that you lost per year. Like today, that was the same in the 30s, but then it went up for 50 years. And in 1970, you had after real inflation about 5% profit with interest rates, not 5% loss. But since the 70s or since 1980, that was the peak, interest rates have collapsed again. From after real inflation, from making a 5% per year to losing 5% per year. That's where we are again today. So it's very likely we're bottoming out here, and from here, interest rates will go up for the next 50 years. Most of us will not. We'll not be on this planet anymore before we reach the peak of interest rates. But it will continue to go up gradually. And this is what has started. In 5 to 10 years, we will have normal interest rates again of not 0%, but 4%. I mean, that's the most likely. But what you see is that during this time, when interest rates bottom out and then they go back up, this is a time of prosperity, because interest rates in the past have reached a low when in combination with a very big crisis, a very big financial crisis, where you have a lot of defaults and where the flight to safety is very high. We saw this in 2008, like the biggest banks all went broke at the same time. And everybody wanted safety, government bonds, long-term government bonds. And so that's why interest rates went down so much. But that's the end of the cycle. It's the same happened in the 1930s. After that, things recover again. Thanks for the great question, Tweety Bird. And that's why stock market is very likely to go up. People think if interest rates go up, that will be bad for the stock market. That's not true. People think that interest rates are set by governments that lead the economy. That's not true. It's not like that. It doesn't work like that. The way it works is that the market sets prices. The market is much bigger than the Fed or the ECB. The ECB and the Fed are just participants of the market. What people buy has a much bigger influence than what the Fed buys. The Fed has much less purchasing power than what the market than the total market. So what you see is that, I've explained this in previous videos. I cannot repeat this. You really have to look at my previous videos where I explain the cycles. The stock market will go up when commodity prices go down. Because commodity prices go down, that means people have much money, more money to spend, because oil prices go down, food prices go down, energy bills go down. So they have more money to spend, and they will spend it on expansion, buy a house, buy more products, buy a car, and this will pump stock prices. That's the start of a bull market, and that's what happened since 2009. But this cycle takes 30 years before there will be a shortage again of commodities. And so the next 20, 30 years, you will see that commodity prices continue to go down, gold also. And thanks to that, people will become more prosperous. And thanks to that, they will spend more. And thanks to that, stock market valuations will go up. And thanks to that, people will want to take on more risk and will start to shift their money from safe investments like bonds, government bonds, to more risky investments like stocks. And that will push up interest rates, because there will be less supply of money to buy these safe assets. And it will also push up stock valuations. So that's very likely to happen. So stock valuation will go up together with interest rates. Hey! Thank you for the great question, Tweety Bird. Yes, Tweety Bird, some people think inflation is higher than 10%. Do you think the government is lying to you? Yes, I've been discussing this a lot on my channel. I think you will enjoy my other videos very much. For example, look for inflation in the title of in my YouTube channel. I made great videos on inflation. And real inflation, in my opinion, is 5.8% per year on average the past 100 years. And this is a very well funded number that I calculated. I have different sources for that. First of all, of course, you can look at prices of consumer goods and services and assets, and how much they go up over time. I did this exercise and commodities, and from this it looks to me that the average is about 5%. I've backed this with actual price histories of many of these items, so you can just find that video, and I will also link it below, but that will only be visible tomorrow then. And that's one source. The prices just go up at 5% per year on average. But of course it depends on what cycle you're in, which prices go up. Like for example, commodities. During prosperity, like the cycle we're in now, when stocks go up, interest rates go up, commodities go down in price. So you won't see much inflation there. But where you do see the inflation is in stock prices and real estate prices prices of art and supercars, and like it depends what cycle you're in, but if you take an average of all these prices, you will see that that is about 5%. So that's one source. The other source is just looking at the amount of money that's printed by the Fed, for example, and the ECB, and there it's about 8% per year on average the past 100 years. And you can simply deduct 2% per year, because, well, the economy grows with 2% per year, so you have 2% more goods and services per year. So if you would have the same amount of money in circulation, you would see that prices go down on average 2% per year, because that's the increase in productivity of these economies. And so that means that if you print 2% per year, well, actually you will see that prices will not go down, but they will stay flat. And if you print 8% per year, well, then you have to deduct 2%, and then you will see, like, yeah, price will go up at 6% per year. This is simple mathematics. You can apply this to these things very easily. And I look at if you want to see how much money they are printing, you have to look at the balance sheet. It's, they don't make a secret about that, how much they are printing. And this is not paper bills. It's mostly digital money that they issue out of thin air and that they use to buy all kind of stuff with or give out all kind of loans. So, but this is about 8% per year, and that is what causes inflation. So yes, I think the government is lying. But on the other hand, they also give you information to make up your own mind. Like, they don't lie about the amount of money they print, and there you can clearly see what the inflation is. So they fool, but they only fool those that are willing to be fooled. Huh? Ricardo says that some people say that negative interest rates on bonds is an indicator for a short-term recession incoming. Well, today there's a lot of talk about the recession coming, and it's usually a good indicator that there's no recession coming. But in my previous videos, I also make the case why I think it's not likely we'll see a recession here. And it's simply because we just had a negative year of stock returns in 2018. So it only happens every 4 years or so during times of prosperity that you have a negative year in the stock market, and we just had it. So it's not likely to happen at this point. And I can't judge whether negative interest rates are a good indicator. I didn't study that. I can't talk on that. So yeah, thanks all for joining on the live show. Very few people today, and I think that's another, only five people. I think that's another confirmation that yes, crypto is depressed, and you should actually really think very well about your allocations and buy if you haven't already. And so I mean, it depends how much exposure you have, but this is a warning that you should not be, you should be investing today, not be overexposed 90%, but also not be underexposed 10%, and be very wise and not have any Bitcoin core. Really invest in those coins that are depressed today, and there are plenty of projects. Thanks all for joining the live show. And I wish you all a great Sunday.